is the four Sankha Diggs, who are manifest before all else, and the 14 Manus are also of my nature and born of my mind, and from them are all these creatures in the world. Shri Krishna is describing his vibhuti, his divine attributes. The first are the seven Maharishi, the seven great sages of old. Shri Krishna then only said Chapara, which literally means four, and from that you must understand it as meaning Sankhadi, the four Satkumars. Then there are the 14 Manus. All of these are born from the Lord's nature and are born from the Lord's mind. All the creatures in this world are because of them. I said earlier in this chapter that in 4th, 5th and 6th verse of this chapter, God describes his 45 vibhuti, divine attributes. How are there 45? In the 4th and 5th verses that Chandni covered last week, the Lord describes 20 different types of feelings. In this verse, the Lord describes the 7 great sages of old, we will see who they are, the 4 Sanatamas and the 14 Manus. Therefore, this is 20 plus 25 equals 45. In 3 verses, God describes his 45 vibhuti, divine attributes. Let us first understand the 7 Maharishis, the 7 great sages. Who are the 7 great sages of old? In the Shanti Parva, the book of peace in the Mahabharat, we are told who these 7 great sages are. Maharishi Angira Cha Atri Prasthya Pulha Krutu Tatishta Iti Satite Manasa Nirmita. So, Maharishi Angira Atrihi Pulastya Praha Krutu and Shishta are the 7 great sages. These are the Maharishis, the great rishis. Who can you call a Maharishi, a great sage? The scriptures give us a definition in the Vayu Purana. Satite Saravishaiva Gunai Satish Smuta Dirga Ishu Mantra Kuta Ishvara Divya Chakshusha Tudda Prataksha Tamano Gotra Pravakashya. Those seven who have attained these 7 qualities attained the state of great sages. First, a long lifespan. Second, having a vision of a mantra. Third, being full of fortune. Fourth, having a divine vision. Fifth, being advanced. Sixth, seeing Dharma truly. And 7, one from whom a lineage begins. There are many rishi sages, but there are only 7 Maharishis, great sages. What are the 7 qualities? First, they have a long lifespan. If I say it another way, they are those who have looked after their bodies. They are wise in the subject of the body. If they are rishi, they are of course wise. Rish from rishi means revolutionary and reformative. When people do not understand the meaning of a word, then they do it so much injustice. When people hear the word rishi, then they immediately think, assume it's someone who's wearing simple orange clothes, has a long beard, has his hair tied in a knot, has a long moustache, is a poor man walking with a stick, has weak bones, and is either sitting or stooping or holding a stick. When you see a person like this, then you immediately think rishi. This doesn't mean rishi. The definition of the word rush is a revolutionary or reformative. Rush grante. A person who is revolutionary or reformative is a rishi. A rishi gives something new to society. The state at which society is in at the moment, but a rishi gives society thoughts about where is it to reach in the future. A rishi is one who talks in the present about what is going to happen 5 years, 10 years, or 50 years' time. The first thing, therefore, needed to become a Maharishi, a great sage, is a long lifespan. The second is that a Maharishi, a great sage, needs to be a visionary of a mantra. The third requirement is that a Maharishi, a great sage, must be Ishvara. Ishvara means one who is full of fortune. A Maharishi, a great sage, can never be poor, unfortunate, unhealthy, helpless, dependent, wearing torn clothes, etc. This is not a Maharishi. Being full of fortune is a requirement for being a Maharishi, a great sage. Yajnavalkya had 70,000 pupils at his hermitage, and Yajnavalkya never came out one day with torn clothes to beg. When Western scholars read this in Upanishads, and they get shocked, they find it strange. If one wishes to set up an orphanage or hermitage for 200 or 500 pupils, then one has to go beg, asking for so much, asking people to give, 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 and society does not give to them. Yajnavalkya had 70,000 pupils and yet never went out in society with his hands held out. And he never even took fees from these 70,000 pupils. One could say that if you're not begging, then you take fees from the pupils. Yajnavalkya never took any fees. When the studies finished, then the pupils, out of the feelings of their hearts, left Guru Dakshina, donations to the Guru. These people thought that the rishi from which we've acquired wisdom should never have to go out begging in front of society, and therefore they gave these donations to him without him asking. This is how hermitages used to run. Ishvara means one who is full of fortune. The fourth requirement
being a Maharishi, a great sage, is having a divine vision. A Maharishi, a great sage, never has a selfish vision. When he looks towards another person, then the first thought that comes to our minds is, how can this person be of use to me? Therefore, this first level is of selfish vision. The second level is of a helpful vision. At this state, one thinks about how he can be of use to the other person. This is how he feels, and this is a good thing. You can call this enlightened self-interest. Before, one used to think, upon seeing another person, how can that other person be of use to him? This is selfish. Then a state may come where one thinks about how he can be of use to another person. This is a good thing, but the third state is that of a divine vision. What is a divine vision? This is when one sees another person, and the first question that comes to his mind is, how can this person be of help to the cause of my God? How can this person be of help to the cause of the divine mission that I'm carrying out? He is not working for me, and I'm not working for him, but we are both for God. This is a divine vision. This is because if the other person was for you, then you would be big and he would be for small. The other person becomes an instrument and you become the power to govern. If you are for the other person, then you become small and the other person becomes big. If you want to help poor people, then you have to find poor people. If all poor people get finished, then it would be difficult for you that there would be no poor people left. If you leave at 7 a.m. in the morning to walk down, let's say, Marine Drive in Mumbai, then a lot of beggars are standing in line, but when it turns 8 a.m., then 8 a.m., there is a difficulty because you've not found any beggars, even though you wanted to give them all bread. If you do not find them, then it will be difficulties. A person who is there to help other people has an attitude that these are the people that will stay like that, and not only that, but these people will remain inferior to him so that one will be able to help the other person. The person needs his own people to massage his ego in a deep corner and apply some ointment to his ego. He would think that no matter if he's harassing 8 people in the world, he's helping 2 people on the other side. This will not work. A person with a divine vision thinks that neither is he big and I small, nor am I big and him small. We're both the same, and both our causes is the supreme soul. A vision like this is a divine vision. This is called Maharishi, great sage. The fifth requirement for Maharishi, great sage, is Vrindha. There is a difference. From our perspective, we think that if a quality of lifespan is given, that if quality Vrindha is given, we think that, what is the use of saying Vrindha? This is because we think that immediately on having a long lifespan, one immediately becomes a Vrindha. We think that Vrindha means a person of old age. We think that when a person has a long lifespan, then he immediately becomes of old age. No, because the meaning of Vrindha has got nothing to do with old age. This is a big mistake of society, in particular in Gujarati, when Gujarati formed out of Sanskrit. When we hear the word Vrindha, then we think of a person with white hair. No. Vrindha means a person who is advanced. A person who is advanced is a Vrindha. This is a person who has attained enhancement. Enhancement in what? A person who has attained enhancement in qualities, enhancement in knowledge, and enhancement in experiences is a Vrindha. A person aged 25 can also be a Vrindha in Sanskrit. This cannot work in English because people say that they are 25 years old. It is not like that. In Sanskrit, a person aged 25 can be a Vrindha if the person has become enhanced in knowledge, in qualities, and experiences. And a person can still be a child at the age of 80 if the person has no qualities, no experiences, and no knowledge. A person can still be a child at the age of 80. This is Vrindha. The sixth quality of a Maharishi, a great sage, is one who can truly see Dharma. He knows properly what Dharma is. This is not a person who stops Dharma at rituals. He knows about what needs to happen so that the person can develop so that it can have an immediate effect on his life. This is why a true Maharishi, a great sage, will never stop you at rituals. He will not keep you stuck in rituals. He will tell you to change your inner qualities. This is because Dharma is an inner qualitative change. A person may have been performing rituals for 40 years, yet it does not show any changes in his life. You see so many people like this in society. To go and sit by the shrine in the morning, noon and evening, this person has been doing this for 40 years, and yet there are no changes in his life. This person is as angry as he was 40 years ago. He is as much on the wrong path today as he was 40 years ago. He may even have got 2 steps further on the wrong path, but never 2 steps back. Is this Dharma? This person has been doing it for 40 years, and yet there are no changes. Dharma changes a person's inner qualities. A Maharishi, a great sage, can truly see Dharma. The seventh quality of a Maharishi, a great sage, is one from whom Gotra, lineage, begins. Even today, people do not know the meaning of Gotra, lineage. If you ask someone what Gotra lineage is, then they will say that they do not know what their Gotra lineage is. If they know little, then they will say that they are from the Kashyap Gotra lineage, because the word Kashyap is very general. A Maharishi, a great sage, is one from whom a lineage begins. All the seven Maharishi, great sages, had lineages, such as the Maharishi Gotra lineage, the Angira Gotra lineage, the Atreya Gotra from Atri. Gotra means lineage. Tatra Laj means, begins from Marisha, great sage. One who has these seven qualities is a Marishi, great sage. These seven Marishis, great sages, are operators of active Dharma. If you look at world history, then Dharma has always been of two types. The first is the Dharma of activity, and the second is the Dharma of passivity. The Marishis, great sages, are of active Dharma. They are continuously performing Satkarma, divine acts. After the Maharishi, great sages, Shri Krishna, in this verse, mentions four. Who are they? They are the four Sankaliks. They are Sanak, Sanandan, Sanatan, and Sanakkar. These are the four Sankaliks. The word Sankalik can be split into Sanak and Adik, meaning Sanak, etc. Stories of them come up over and over again in the scriptures, such as the Sanakumars went there, or the Sanakumars went there. There are four of them, and they are also sons from the mind of Brahma. Shri Krishna does not only say Chattvar four, but also Urve Chattvar, meaning the four that become manifest before all. They are there right from the beginning of the world. They are forms of God. If you want a basic understanding of the Sankadiks, then I will say that they were born before all else, yet if you look at the ages, they look just like five-year-old children. Their bodies are like this. They have so much innocence. What I mean to say is that they were born at the beginning of the world, and yet they still have innocence of five-year-olds. The age of five has a lot of importance, because if one is of younger, then they have a lack of understanding. A five-year-old child begins to understand and begins to find out about the world, yet the deformities have not entered. Such is the age of five. If there is a child of 1.5 years or 2 years, then it doesn't understand anything. The poor child is in darkness. A five-year-old child is such that the child understands, but the deformities have not yet entered. These Sankaliks are understanding, and yet the deformities have not yet entered. Therefore, it looks as if the age is five. The Sankaliks keep moving in the three worlds, and keep preaching about devotion, knowledge, and attachment. Bhakti, Jnana, and Karma. In the second chapter of the Padma Purana, which are six chapters describing the greatness of the Srimad Bhagavat, the Sankaliks are described, and it is said that they have the following characteristics. Hari Sharanam Evam Hi Nitya Yesha Mukhya Evacha. Always from their mouths comes the repetition of the mantra Hari Sharanam, meaning I seek refuge in Hari, I seek refuge in Hari. This is the recognition of the Sankaliks. Hari Sharanam, I seek refuge in Hari, I seek refuge in Hari. These four are lovers of discourses of the Srimad Bhagavat. They get a lot of bliss whenever they speak about the Srimad Bhagavat. Because there are four of them, they have facilities that if one of them can become the speaker, the remaining three can become the listeners, so that discourses can keep going on. Because of them, discourses of the Srimad Bhagavat never finish. They keep listening and speaking about the Srimad Bhagavat. Shri Krishna then says, in this verse mentions the 14 Manus. We have done the calculations already, so I won't say it again. 14 Manus are born in one day of Brahma. One period of the world is one day of Brahmaji. 40 Manus are born in one day of Brahmaji. In this period of ours, who are the 40 Manus? If you want to write the list, then they are, number 1, Swayabhu, number 2, Swarachis, number 3, Uttama, number 4, Tamas, number 5, Raivat, number 6, Chakshush, number 7, Vaivasvata, number 8, Savarni, number 9, Daksha Savarni, number 10, Brahma Savarni, number 11, Dharma Savarni, number 12, Rudra Savarni, number 13, Dev Savarni, and number 14, Indra Savarni. Savarni does not mean broom like in Gujarati. These are the 14 Manus. What do they do? From Brahmaji's orders, they give birth and initiation to the world. At this moment, the age of Brahmaji is 51, and this is the 51st year of Brahmaji. In this year, Vibhasvara, who is the 7th Manu, is ruling. Whenever you sit down to do rituals, then you should listen to the prayers that Brahmins chant. You're holding the pot of water during this time, but if you listen with attention, then the following will come. Vishnu, 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 Srimad Bhagavato, Mahapurushasya, Vishnu Raghdaya Pavamanasi, Adya Brahmano Ritiye Pate, Shri Svata Parakalpe, Vaivasvata Manavantare, Kaliyuga Kali, Prathama Charane Asampade Sare. At the moment, the period of the Vaivasvata Manu is running. Manu means Manasa Vaha, meaning those who have feelings for me and I have feelings for them. Not only that, but Manu also means Manasa Jata Iti Manasaha, meaning those have manifested for the result of the mind. The entire progeny of the Manus in the mature world, Yesham Loka Imam Prat Vaja. There are two types of progeny if one wishes to understand who they are and if one wishes to understand the material world. There can be two types of progeny. There are many, but these are the main two. One type of progeny is that which is born from the relations of a man and a woman. The second type of progeny is that which is born from birds. In the West, there is a thought of Virgin Mary and Jesus being born. These people do not know how it can work. There's an interpretation of this. It may not be a final one, but it is certainly an interpretation. And how it can happen because the scriptures have believed in this type of progeny. How can progeny be born from words? Progeny can be born from initiation, mantras, and messages. Just like a father calls his son Vatsa, son, in the same way a guru can call his pupil Vatsa, son. The guruji can say to his pupil, speak, son. Their progeny is born from words and messages. The guru has given an initiation to a pupil, and that is why the pupil is of the guru. The guru has given a mantra and a message to a pupil. Progeny is born in this way. And progeny is born when a man unites with a woman, and the scriptures call the progeny Bindja. When progeny is born from words, the scriptures call this progeny Nadaraja. Nadaraja. Nad means vibrations. There are these two types of progeny in the world. What is the reason for this? The seven great sages got married and entered into household life. We've read already that Vishishta married Arundhati, Atri married Anusuya. The seven great sages got married and they had progeny. When this happened, then the progeny was the Bindja progeny from when man unites with the woman. That is why we say that they have a Gotra lineage. They are the creators and progenitors of Gotra lineages. The Sankalpiks did not get married, but they preached and this began the tradition. Their pupils heard their preachings and may have had progeny that was Binduja, progeny from the union of a man and woman, but because they took a higher path, this progeny became Nadaja, progeny born from vibrations and sounds. When Brahmins were given general sacred threads, then they are called Dvija, thrice-born. When one gets a sacred thread, then they become thrice-born. There is one reason for this. Dvija can be split into Dvi, meaning twice, and Ja, meaning born. Therefore, Dvija is one who is thrice-born. One birth comes from the union of the mother and the father, which is Bindu, just like all of us are, but those who are Nad progeny, who are born from words and sounds, are born a second time, are initiated, have a mantra, and get the preachings. One can only become Dvija, thrice-born, when they tie a relationship with the guru. Janmana jayate shrutya sanskara dvija uchate. We are all siddhas from birth, but through values we become twice born. Until this relationship with the guru is not tied, then they cannot become dvija twice born, and are therefore siddhas. Progeny can be of two types. Bindja, born of union between a man and a woman, and nadija, born from vibrations and sounds. In this world, there are these types of progeny. This verse was very informative. Shri Krishna said that the seven great sages of old, the four sankaliks who are manifest before all else, and the 14 manus, are also of my nature and born of my mind, and from them are all these creatures in the world. The next verse will show us how this is. Verse 7.